Thank you very much, Professor Vars, and good morning to all the participants. Today, I will talk to you and give a brief introduction to the satellite navigation. What is navigation? Navigation is a process of planning, reading, controlling the movement of a craft or a vehicle from one place to another place. That is, when a vehicle, a car, ship or aircraft moves, you have to plan it, how it has to move, read some, make some readings and control the vehicle. This is basically, the whole art of this is called navigation. It is derived from Latin roots, navis, meaning ship, and agere, meaning to move or to direct. All navigation techniques involve locating the navigator's position compared to known locations or patterns. So, when a ship enters harbor, you should know with respect to harbor, which are known locations around that, it has to navigate and enter the harbor. So, that is how you have to locate the navigator position compared to the known locations. It basically deals with auto-locating any vehicles in land like a car, sea like a ship, or the space like an aircraft. It is characterized by four main aspects: determination of destination where you have to reach, choice of a suitable route while going to that place from your current position, estimation of course and speed during the movement, and regular continuous monitoring of the progress of the vehicle when it moves. Basically, what does satellite navigation provides? It provides position, that is latitude, longitude, and height. It also gives velocity, velocity north, velocity east, and velocity upward direction. And also, it can give time, universal time coordinates, that is maintained at Paris, to any user in land, air, or sea. Because position, velocity, time, this service is also abbreviated and written as PVT. PVT service is same as navigation. Before going further, you should have basic knowledge about geodesy. That is, what is basically how the latitude, longitude, and height is different. The surface of the earth is uneven, like a mountains and valleys. So there are more ups and downs, and it is very irregular. So the physical surface of the earth is very irregular, and it is very difficult to assign some values and do calculation on this. So the geodesists, what they did is, they approximated the physical surface to an ellipsoid, that is shown green color in this, and that approximates the physical surface. An ellipsoid is basically an ellipse rotating about the semi-minor axis. In olden days, there was also another surface that is called geoid or mean sea level, and the heights were measured with respect to this geoid or mean sea level. But presently, in satellite navigation, this geoid is not used, and it is only basically ellipsoid that is used to define latitude, longitude, and height. So this is basically an Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate system used in satellite navigation. So you have got here the center of the Earth at this point, and you have an ellipsoid like this. An ellipsoid can be defined if you know semi-major axis and semi-major axis A and B, or semi-major axis E and A and eccentricity E. So this is the center. You can have a coordinate system X, Y, Z. This X axis is an intersection of the Greenwich meridian. This is the Greenwich meridian intersecting with the equatorial plane, this plane, and this is defined as x-axis. 90 degree perpendicular to that is y-axis, and perpendicular to both x and y-axis and passing through the Earth's axis of rotation is the z-axis. So suppose the navigator is at a point P above the ellipsoid at a height h. This is the height of the navigator above the ellipsoid. You draw a normal to the ellipsoid P0 and ascent is down, it will not pass through the center, it will go down like this. And angle made by this PP0 extended with respect to the XY plane is called latitude of the navigator. And you draw a meridian passing through P0, that is a normal drawn from P to the ellipsoid. And angle between this meridian and the meridian passing through Greenwich, lambda, is called longitude. So basically you have got longitude lambda, latitude phi, and height h defined in the Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate system. Because the Earth is supposed to be not rotating in this system, and it is centered with respect to the Earth. You can also have an X, Y, and Z coordinate, Cartesian coordinates. X, this is the distance of this Y, and also Z, this direction. So either you can use lambda, phi, and h, that is the polar coordinates, or the Cartesian coordinates, X, Y, Z. Whenever you use an ellipsoid, there are various ellipsoids existing. And whenever maps are prepared, a particular ellipsoid is chosen. Everest spheroid or Everest ellipsoid is the oldest system. The equator radius is so much, polar radius is so much, and inverse of the flattening is so much. Flattening means F, and inverse of that 1 by F, where F is A minus B by A. That is the difference between semi-major axis and semi-major axis divided by A. This is basically used in India, olden days. There are international ellipsoids that is used by Europe. All the maps are with respect to international. Russia has got its own system, Krasovsky. Australia has got Australian national system. South America has got South American system. The GRS-80 that is used for laser tracking. The North American datum, the NAD. And this is the WGS-84 that is used in GPS. So all of them have got different semi-major axis, equatorial radius, polar radius, and inverse of the flattening. Now coming to the navigation, the most critical state of navigation is when an aircraft lands at an airport. That is the most critical stage. It is more than navigating a ship or a car on a road where the visible things are available very clearly. Usually an aircraft enters at an angle 45 degree, it goes down like this, then runs parallel to the runway, it will be able to see the runway, and then turn around base station and a final approach point reach here. At this point, he will be deciding whether to land or not. And afterwards, this reaching the point, he will be knowing that he will be centering his plane above at the center of the runway, because he will be able to see the runway, and that is how he lands. But this is a final approach fix. So the aircraft has to be navigated very well from entry point to the downward base and all this up to this point, and once this point is reached to a certain accuracy, the aircraft will land. Similarly, when the aircraft leaves, it will be going up. If it is an upward wind, it will be straight out departure. Crosswind, it will be going like this. So it has to be navigated up from this point, leaving this point, to a particular height. So that is where the navigation is very important. But all along the way, from one airport to another airport also, he needs navigation. So navigation is needed by aircraft everywhere, but while landing, it is very, very critical. Landing generally involves five phases of flight. They are, one is arrival phase, where the pilot navigates to the initial approach phase, at IAF, where holding can take place. He can roam around and then decide and get whether to land or not from the air traffic control. Then there is the initial approach, where the phase of the flight after the initial approach fix, where the pilot commences navigation of the aircraft to the final approach fix, where he will be aligning to the runway, from where a safe control descent back towards the airport can be initiated. That is the initial approach phase. Then there can be an intermediate approach. It is not necessary, but in more complex approaches that will be required to navigate to the final approach fix. Then there is a final approach between 4 to 12 nautical miles of straight flight descending at a set rate at an angle between 2.5 degrees to 6 degrees. Then there is a missile approach, an optional phase should be the required visual reference for landing. Note have been obtained at the end of the final approach. This allows the pilot to climb the aircraft to a safe altitude and navigate to a position to hold for weather improvement or from where another approach can be commenced. So these are all the five different phases of landing. Then basically the approach after the final approach fix are classified as either precision or non-precision, depending on the accuracy and capability of the navigation aids, that is navigators. Precision approach uses both lateral, that is called using a localizer, or vertical information. So it gets a horizontal information and vertical information. And non-precision approaches provide only lateral information. No vertical information is provided to the aircraft. Some of the airports where the air traffic is dense, where one flight take lands and the other takes off at every 5 minutes, precision approach standards is important to be implemented. On the other hand, at airports where the air traffic is not so dense, maybe a few landings take place per day, it is enough to implement what is called non-precision approach standards. As defined by International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO, which is responsible for implementing safe air navigation, precision landing systems are separated into three categories. That is category 1, category 2, and category 3. And category 3 is further divided into category 3A, category 3B, and category 3C. I will come to the details of all these categories. The classification depends mainly on three parameters. One is a decision height of the aircraft above the terrain while landing. That is a particular height is chosen, that is called decision height, where the aircraft will take a pilot will take a decision to land or not. Then at that point, whether the runway is visible or not, how clearly it is visible. So the second point is the visibility condition of the runway. That is a decision height. And also the air traffic density, how many aircrafts are landing and other, so that air traffic density. So these three parameters, decision height, visibility condition, air traffic density, is used to define the different kinds of approach. You should always nominate a decision height with a decision point with a decision height where you will abandon the takeoff or discontinue approach if things are not going as expected. For takeoff, this is the point at which there is sufficient distance available to safely stop the aircraft should it accelerate lower than expected or suffer a power loss. This is particularly important for multi-engine aircraft. For landing, this point with a specified decision height is that point below which the pilot must not descend unless adequate visual references have been obtained. Once the decision height and point are reached, landing will continue by visual means or a missile approach must be executed. This is how the landing takes place. Category 1 operations have a decision height of 200 feet and a visibility greater than 800 meters. That is, the pilot should be able to see the runway from a distance of 800 meters. Category 2, decision height is 200 to 100 feet and 300 meter runway visual range is necessary. Category 3A, operations have a decision height between 100 to 0 feet with runway visual range of 200 meter or more. Category 3B, operations have a decision height between 50 and 0 feet and runway visual range between 200 to 50 meter. Finally, category 3C has no limitation on either decision height or visibility. That is, the aircraft need not see the runway and it will be landing. Like whenever there is a fog or mist, it will be able to land. That is category 3C landing. So this diagram shows the dimensions of a tunnel, that is category 1, 2, and 3 navigation. This is called tunnel concept. The aircraft should enter a tunnel, that is inner tunnel. There is an outer tunnel and an inner tunnel. The aircraft should enter from the final approach point into the tunnel all along the center and then land into that. So these are the dimensions of the category 1, category 2, and category 3 tunnels, inner tunnel and outer tunnel. This is decision height 200 feet, lateral height of plus or minus 40 meter to 120 meter, vertical plus or minus 12.1 to 36.3 meter. This is the inner tunnel and this is the outer tunnel. Similarly for category 2, category 3, values are given. Category 3, the dimensions of the inner tunnel is smaller than the dimensions of the category 1 inner tunnel. This is another diagram, airport approach. So usually the vertical error should be less than 5 meter and indicating each position estimate that the vertical alert limit is 10 meter and probability of vertical alert should be less than 10 to the power minus 7. So these are the typical figures. Category 2 decision height 100 feet, category 1 decision height at this point, and this is a final approach point. Final approach point, this is a category 1 decision. So you should be able to guide from up to this category 1, for category 1 up to this, and then you will be landing with manually seeing the runway. Category 2, it is closer to the touchdown point. So this is another diagram. This is the ILS, which is providing now terrestrial system that is providing the thing. It is around 233 feet away from the runway threshold. For category 1, it is 200 feet. Category 2, 100 feet. Category 3 is here. So at present, it is this much. For the future, it should be nearer and nearer. Better, closer, you should be able to provide navigation. There are basically four parameters that define the accuracy standards for navigation. In the air called Required Navigation Performance, RFP, RNP. One is accuracy. That is degree of conformance of a vehicle's measured position with its true position. Suppose an instrument measures a position and a true position it is there, the difference between that, how close they are, how close the measured value is to the true position. If the value is 5 meter, the measured value should be as close as 5 meter to the true value. So that is called accuracy. Then the integrity, it is the ability to provide timely warnings when part or all of the navigation system is providing erroneous information and that should not be used for navigation. That is the ability to provide timely warning. That is called integrity. Once the start system misbehaves, the pilot should be informed. Availability, that is the probability that at any time the system will meet the accuracy and integrity requirements during the complete period of navigation, starting from leaving the airport during the flight mode and also landing. So that is the probability at any time the system will meet a particular accuracy and integrity requirement during the complete period of navigation. What is that probability? And continuity is another again probability that a service will continue to be available for a specified period of navigation, given that it is available at the beginning of the period. That is from the beginning of the navigation, what is the probability that it will continue to provide that service? So for land and maritime requirement, these are the values. For land, accuracy is 1 to 10 meter. For maritime ships, it is 1 to 100 meter. This is the integrity value 99.99%. Availability 99.9 and 99.99%. And the position of rate for land, 1 second to 10 minutes and 1 second to 10 seconds for a sea. So these are the definitions which are repeated. Now, these are the required aircraft navigation performance RNP. For en route navigation, when an aircraft had left the airport and is high in the sky and going towards the destination, that is called en route navigation. The accuracy required is very small, only horizontal accuracy required 3.7 km, so that it does not collide with any other aircraft. Integrity is 1 minus 10 to the power minus 7 per hour. Time to alert, every 5 minutes there should be alert to be given if the system works or not. And continuity is this number. And availability is 0.99 to 0.99999. This is a terminal when it is approaching to the aircraft airport. The horizontal accuracy, integrity, time to alert 15 seconds, and these are the continuity and availability. Initial approach, a non-precision approach, 220 meter horizontal, integrity, time to alert, continuity, and availability. Now there is an APV1 that is intermediate between non-precision approach and category 1 precision. Now onwards, till now, horizontal accuracy is enough for non-precision approach. But in precision approach, you should know, you need to have accuracy in both horizontal and vertical direction. So this is for APV1, 220 meter horizontal and 20 meter vertical. For APV2 or category 1, it is 16 meter horizontal and 8 meter in vertical direction. This is a typical accuracy needed. So any satellite navigation system should be able to meet this 16 meter horizontal accuracy and 8 meter vertical. These are the other figures. Every 6 seconds, the position should be updated. And also, there should be alert whether the system is working or not. And these are the other figures of continuity available. So this should be met by any system that is providing category 1 precision approach. So these figures for category 1, 2 and 3 requirements. Vertical position accuracy for category 1, 7.7 to 4.4 meter. Category 2, 2 meter. Category 3, 2 meter. Integrity, time to alert 6 seconds for category 1. 2 seconds. Every 2 seconds, you should be alerted whether it is working or not. This is a continuity service availability. There are essentially three navigation systems presently in wide use. They are Inertial Navigation System, INS, Terrestrial Radio Navigation System, or Satellite Navigation System. Before satellite navigation was thought of, both Inertial Navigation System and Terrestrial Radio Navigation System have been used by aircraft and ships. They are still used in ships and aircraft. That is the Inertial Navigation System as well as Terrestrial Radio Navigation System. An inertial navigation system basically contains an accelerometer that measures the acceleration of the vehicle, gyroscopes that measures the direction, servo systems, and computers. The accelerometer measures changes in speed or direction along the axis in which they lie. Their output is a voltage or a series of pulses proportional to whatever acceleration is experienced. The gyroscopes measure the three angles, pitch, roll, and yaw. Alternately, the output of each gyro is connected to a servo motor driving the appropriate gimbal, thus keeping the gimbal in a constant orientation to the inertial space. So these are the three directions of pitch, roll, and yaw. Yaw is this axis, that is nose left or right about an axis running, and this is a pitch axis, and this is a roll axis. Roll rotation about an axis running nose to left. So when the aircraft flies using the gimbal, the aircraft will be, when it is tumbled, it will be kept so that it will be at a particular angle in these three directions. So I will not go into the details of inertial navigation system because it is more or less will be replaced soon. But it has got the following advantages. It is self-contained. It requires minimal outside information, unlike in satellite navigation where you need a satellite. It cannot be jammed because no transmission of radio signals. It is not affected by adverse weather conditions. It does not radiate any energy. It is not detectable by enemy sensors. But they have the following disadvantages and cannot be used for category 1 landing. In inertial navigation system, the most popular one even now for ships, the accuracy degrades with time of departure from the starting point of navigation. When the ship leaves or aircraft leaves the airport, the accuracy degrades with time. So after some time, the aircraft or ship will be deviating away from the destination, and it has to be guided back again to the destination. So that is one of the very difficult thing that INS is not good for long distance navigation. To maintain accuracy over a long period of time, INS requires position updated by some other navigation system. This is a disadvantage of INS. Terrestrial radio navigation system. One of the principles used in terrestrial radio navigation system is hyperbolic position system. And there are basically two systems, Omega and Loran. So in this, what is done is, there will be a master station transmitting exactly a wave, radio wave, exactly synchronized with a clock, very well synchronized. And there will be two slave stations, station A and station B, which are also well synchronized, and they will be transmitting radio waves. These three at three different wavelengths, three different frequencies. So suppose the ship or somebody is here, you are located here, when you are, the time travel from the master station to this point and time taken by slave station to this point, the time difference is measured by the ship because they are left at the same time. So the time difference between these two signals will give a time difference value, and it will show that the user is lying all along this rectangular hyperbola. That is, this is a hyperbola where it is equidistant from both master and slave. That is, the time difference is a constant at this point. Similarly, with the slave station A and master station, you can have another parabola like this. So the intersection of these two hyperbolas will give the position. This is basically the principle of terrestrial radio navigation system, basically omega and Lorentz. So it is based on the measurement of difference in time of arrival of radio waves from the transmitters on the ground to the receivers on the aircraft. The system consists of one master station and two or more slave stations. The points of constant time difference between master station M and D fall on a spherical hyperbola with the transmitters as a foci. If a second time difference is made between two stations M and B, we get a second hyperbola. The intersection of these two hyperbolas will determine the position of the craft. User receivers typically convert this navigation field to latitude longitude for operator convenience. So this is basically a principle of terrestrial radio navigation system. The third system is a VOR DME. It is the present ICAO world standard primary air navigation system for en route, terminal and non-precision approach navigation. It has been approved by International Civil Aviation. So smaller airports like Baroda and Tirupati like that, they will be having only VOR DME. It is VHF population range and distance measuring equipment. It is the most popular terrestrial radio navigation system used today by aircraft for en route navigation and approach, non-approach. These are usually installed at airports and provide aircraft both azimuth and distance information. Almost all airports in the world have VOR DME installations. VOR provides azimuth and DME measures distance to touchdown point to an aircraft by flying over an airport or landing. So that is the principle of VOR DME. Instrument landing system is a ground-based instrument approach system which provides precision guidance to an aircraft approaching a runway. It uses radio signals in many cases, high-intensity writing arrays to enable safe landing during instrument meteorologic conditions such as low ceilings or reduced visibility. So these are radio signals are used in this along with high-intensity lighting arrays on either side of the runway. It consists of basically a localizer which provides a lateral guidance, that is horizontal guidance, and a glide slope that provides glide path, that is the vertical information. So the aircraft is supposed to land at an angle of 3 degrees. So it will, any deviation from that particular path, the localizer will give how far he is deviating from that in the local lateral direction, and he will be guided to come back to original position. And a glide slope will provide the vertical deviation from the required landing path. In summary, VOR DME is not accurate enough to provide CAT 1 precision approach, but is used in many airports around the world for non-precision approach and en route navigation. ILS is accurate to provide CAT 1 approach and is used in many airports now. It cannot provide CAT 2 and CAT 3 precision approach. Moreover, it has other limitation problems of sighting, frequency and location, cost. The cost is very high, and performance and maintenance also. Once it fails, again, during the maintenance time, no service can be provided. And not a single terrestrial radio navigation system can be used as sole means of navigation in all phases and categories of flight. With the successful launching of artificial satellites in 1915, the whole concept of navigation took a new turn, and satellite navigation techniques have become popular now. Basically, a satellite navigation system consists of three segments: a space segment, a control segment, and a user segment. So these are the elements. A space segment where minimum 4 satellites will be visible to a user. It can be aircraft, a car or a ship, so minimum four satellites would be visible to the user. These satellites send some signals, that is basically a PRN code synchronized to atomic clock on board, and also its position information, that is Keplerian parameters. These two are transmitted to the user. These parameters, actually these signals are received on a monitor station all over the world, round the clock, and this data is given to a control station, and control station determines the future orbital parameters for typically about 12 hours next, and uplinks this orbital parameter to the satellite. The satellite transmits this orbital parameter along with the PRN code to the users. Using PRN code, the user will determine the distance to the satellite, and using the broadcast frequencies will determine the satellite position. And knowing the satellite position and distance to minimum four satellites, he can calculate its position. So this is basically the principle of satellite navigation. So the space event consists of a cluster of orbiting satellites or a cluster of orbiting come geostationary satellites. They are either at a medium Earth orbit around 20,000 kilometers or medium plus geostationary orbit. They carry an atomic clock on board, which is the heart of the satellite navigation system. Actually, the measurement of distance to a satellite, that is called pseudo range, to get an accuracy of about 3 meters or better, we need a clock to be an atomic clock where the stability is very good. And if the stability is poor, you cannot achieve an accuracy of 3 meter distance. So that is the heart of the satellite navigation system. They carry a transmitter, receiver, and a memory. Transmitter to transmit a PRN code and a message, satellite navigation message, and a receiver on the satellite to receive uploaded messages, broadcast signals from the control segment, and a memory to store the orbital information or the navigation data. The satellite receiver on board receives the satellite ephemeris data and satellite clock correction parameters called navigation data, which are valid for next 12 hours from the control segment and stores them in this memory. So this is space equipment. The navigation data is actually computed and transmitted to satellites from ground station, which is part of the control segment, whenever the satellite passes over the ground station. This data is stored by the satellite in its memory, and satellite retransmits the data valid at the time of transmission on two frequencies derived from the atomic clock. The satellite also transmits a time synchronized code for ranging. The satellite also transmits a clear time derived from the satellite clock. The control segment, that is the second part, consists of a worldwide network of satellite tracking stations. A master control station which receives the satellite tracking data from the tracking stations in real time. And a computer center co-located with the master control station that computes the future orbital parameters including the perturbation or next 12 hours. That is the Keplerian parameters and perturbation. The master station also has a precise atomic clock maintaining a reference time, which is used to compare the satellite clock and determine the offset and also their correction parameter. This data is stored and transmitted to the respective satellite by the control segment whenever that satellite passes over. So this is basically the control segment. The user segment consists of a user receiver. It can be a chip or a handheld receiver. It receives satellite transmission, basically a PRN code and a satellite orbital information. The receiver receives, determines the range of a visible satellite. The receiver also receives the navigation data and computes its position in real time using an online computer. I will come to the details now. Basically, the principle of satellite navigation is called trilateration. That is, if you have got three satellites and know their position very well, the intersection of the distance to the three satellites gives the position of the user. That is called trilateration. Suppose you know the distance to this satellite one, the user will be somewhere lying on this sphere, part of the sphere I shown here, anywhere on this sphere. Distance to the second satellite, that is range, the user will be somewhere lying on this sphere. And the distance to the third satellite, the user will be anywhere on this sphere. So intersection of these three spheres will give the position. So if you know the distance to satellite, three satellites minimum, and also know the satellite position, you can determine the position using three satellites. So this is basically the principle of satellite navigation known as trilateration. So if you have three satellites whose positions are well known and you determine the ranges to satellites, you can write the three equations for ranges. The ranges are functions of the satellite position and the receiver position. If XSI, VSI, ZSI are the ith satellite coordinates, I is equal to 1 to 3, XU by ZU are the user position, then we can write the three observation equation for three satellites in three unknowns, XU by ZU, that is user position, as R1 is equal to square root of XS1 minus XU square plus VS1 minus VU square plus ZS1 minus ZU square. Similarly for the other two. These three equations are basically equations for spheres, because it is second order equation. And the solution of the three unknowns XU by ZU are given by the intersection of these three spheres defined. So this is basically the principle of trilateration. Here you note, the unknowns XU by ZU are inside the square root. So the basically the equations are non-linear. They are not three equations and three unknowns, a linear equation in three unknowns. So you have to solve that by converting into a linear form and then solve. So in this phase segment consists of at least four satellites visible to a satellite at a time. Typically, three satellites at a near circular orbit about, typically these satellites are circular orbit about 20,000 kilometers above the Earth. Why four satellites? I will tell you three satellites are enough. But why four satellites? I will come to that point later. They carry an atomic clock, either a cesium bomb or a rubidium wave, paper, a memory, a known pseudorandom noise, and a code generator and a dual frequency transmitter. Now the PRL code is a unique binary sequence of zeros and ones, which has the appearance of having been chosen on the basis of repeated coin tosses. They look random. But a priori information of the sequence of bits, which repeats, say, for example, every 1 millisecond, it is only partially random, and the name pseudo-random nodes. And each satellite is assigned different PRN codes, which are well synchronized to atomic clock. I will show you a PRN code now. So this is a simple PRN code, repeating here, is a 10111 like that. You see here, as a whole, it looks like random, but you see here, the pattern 1041. Again, it repeats 1041. So it, every time here, it repeats. So it is a repeating code at every 1 millisecond or like that, but it looks random. So if you know a priori what is this code, you can know the you can generate this code on the ground with respect to your own clock and received clock. You can measure the time delay and measure the distance. So this is basically a sample PRN code that is transmitted by the satellite. The navigation data basically contains, which are determined by a control segment and uploaded, orbital parameters, that is satellite vehicle ephemeris data, basically six Keplerian parameters and their perturbation, satellite clock correction data, that is satellite clock offset, which is pretty standard type, coefficients of a corpuscular ionospheric border to correct for the ionospheric delay of the signal, parameters required to compute universal time coordinator, because all the time has to be common, and a common time use is called universal time. So even the satellite clocks or ground clock will be offset with respect to this, which is maintained in Paris. So there should be parameter transmitted to correct to compute UTC, and telemetry and handover words, which are required to synchronize the receiver clock to satellite clock and get also the almanac data of other satellites. So what the receiver does is, receiver knows, suppose it wants to measure the distance to a satellite 1. The receiver knows a priori what is the PRN code assigned to that. And it generates a replica of the PRN code, synchronizes its own local crystal clock, which is offset with respect to satellite clock by say built-in time. Local crystal clock is not synchronized with atomic clock. So it is offset by say delta t. But it generates its own code similar to that is transmitted by the satellite. So the code generator at the satellite receiver on the ground and satellites are not in same synchrony. They are at different times. The user see or what it does is, it matches the PRN code received from each satellite and correlates it with the locally generated replica and measures the shift in time required by shifting the locally generated replica to match exactly the receiver code. It receives the satellite clock which will be coming with a time delay. So what it does is shift the local PRN code, that is replica, to match with the received code and measures the time delay between the received code and the generated code. Assuming that radio waves travel with the velocity light, which is not true due to the presence of ionosphere and troposphere, and multiplication of time delay by that velocity light, the range of satellite can be determined. So since four satellites transmit different PRL codes, you can determine even simultaneously four ranges by the receiver. Say they are R1 dash, R2 dash, R3 dash, R4 dash. So the receiver determines four pseudo ranges to four satellites simultaneously by generating four different codes and matching with the receiver code. So this is a, at the time of leaving the satellite, all the four satellites will be transmitting a PRL code assigned to that at the same time. But each one will arrive with a time delay. This one is here, another one is here, third one is here, fourth one is here. There are different time delay, delta T1, delta T2, delta T3, delta T4, with respect to the pulse which, code which has left the satellite. So this is received on the ground. So you can measure the time delay and multiply by velocity light, you will give the pseudo range R1 dash, R2 dash, R3 dash, and R4 dash. So that is basically the principle of ranging. Basically, it is one-way ranging. That is, only the satellite transmit and received on the ground. It is not transmitted from the ground and measured again after receiving. So a basic measurement made by the satellite navigator receiver is the apparent transit time of the PRL signal from the satellite to the receiver, defined as the difference between the signal reception time as determined by the receiver clock T2 and the transmission time of the satellite T1 as marked on the signal by TLM and handover. Actually, what is done is the receiver knows the time at which each pulse has left, and the pulse which has generated locally, the same replica of that which is locally, is also ignores the time. The time difference between locally generated replica and the received, the time at which the satellite has left from the satellite can be measured, and that is why TLM and telemetry and handover words are used. This is part of the navigation meter. So in fact, in all satellite navigation system, this TLM and handover words are used to know at which time the satellite signal has left and at which time it is received on the ground is measured by the receiver clock and the distance measure. It is measured as the time amount of time shift required to align the PRL code replica generated at the receiver to the signal received from the satellite. This measurement is biased due to the fact that the satellite receiver clocks are not perfectly synchronized, and each keeps time independently. Because satellite has got its own atomic clock, ground receiver has got its own crystal clock. So both are offset by a common reference time, satellite by delta TS and receiver by time delta T. So the distance measure is not exact geometric range. They are, I got additional time delay, delta TS and delta TU. So this is basically the principle. Satellite generator code here. The code will arrive with a time delay here. At this time, T2 it arrives. Receiver will generate the same code here at this local thing. And the receiver code, the satellite receiver code is matched. Time delay is measured. Multiply by velocity light will give the distance. So basically, the distance between satellite and ground is this is a geometric distance, which is R1, R2, R3, R4. But we are not able to measure that because of the different errors. One of the basic errors is that satellite clock is offset with respect to the standard time. Delta TS1, delta TS2, delta TS3, and delta TS4. So there is a delay error C times delta TS in each one of that. So the distance measure will be by an error C times delta TS. Then there is a receiver clock offset, which is common for all the four distance measurement, C times delta TU. Well, delta TU is a receiver clock offset with respect to a standard time. And delta TA, which is the residual error remaining in the atmospheric after correction due to Klobuchar model and neglecting the tropospheric error. So we have got delta T atmospheric delay, receiver error, and satellite clock error. So the distance measure is exactly more. That is R1, you want to measure this distance R1, it will be R1 plus C delta TS1 plus C delta TU plus C delta TA atmospheric delay. So like that for the four satellites. So if XSI, YSI, ZSI are the right satellite coordinates, X, Y, Z, D are the user position, then we can write the four observation equation for four clock, four satellites at a time, as recorded by the receiver clock. The satellite coordinate should be calculated as a character receiver clock time T character for signal transit time, estimated using the most recent satellite and receiver coordinates one. So that is a must. You can write the equation as R1 dash is square root of X S1 minus X over square plus Y S1 minus Y over square plus Z S1 minus Z over square plus D delta T. It is after the correction for satellite clock error and atmosphere. So you have got four equations in four unknowns, X U, Y U, Z U, and delta T. So these are the four spheres which intersect as a common user location as shown in next sphere. See, these four equations are nonlinear because the unknowns are inside the square root. Only delta T is outside that. So we can write F as R1 dash, the difference between the pseudo range and this equation, and R2 dash F. So these four equations are written like this. F is a function of X, U, Y, U, Z, U, and delta T. So this is a navigation equation. Intersection of the four spheres gives a solution. So this is, has to be determined by solving the four equation as shown. So what is done is, let X U dash, Y U dash, Z U dash, delta T U dash be known approximately the best estimate of your user position and delta T. That is possible because you know approximately where you are and you know the coordinates in Cartesian system, and approximately some value of delta T U, you take it. And let dxu, dyu, dzu, and delta t, d delta t, be the correction to the a priori value to get to the actual position. And let dri dash be the difference between actual measurement ri dash and the nominal pseudo range measurement ri, that is got by using this a priori best estimates of xu, yu, zu, and delta t. So the nominal pseudo range measurements obtained by using this equation, knowing X2 dash, Y2 dash, Z2 dash, and delta 2 dash. So the difference between that is DR dash. You can now write that equation by a Taylor series like this, where DF by DXU is XS7 minus XU dash by RA, like that. So F0 is the value of F using the a priori best estimate of XU, YU, ZU. You can determine the F0 by a priori value, approximate value. Then these are the partial derivatives as a function of the unknown values. So they are the directional cosines or directional derivatives of XU by U, ZU, and local clock time DTU unknown, delta TU. So the above equation can be written in matrix form AX is equal to DRI dash, where DRI dash is RI dash minus RI. That is the pseudo range measured minus RI, that is range determined using a priori value. Then these are the A matrix, and DR is the unknown, the correction for X, Y, U, Z, U, delta T, U from the a priori values. So we can write AX is equal to DRI dash. The matrix solution is given by DR is equal to A transpose A inverse into A transpose that DRI dash. So this equation, this matrix equation can be solved. And you get a new value of DXU, DYU, DZU, delta T. So the equation is linear. It can be used to express the relationship between errors of the pseudo range measurement and user quantities also. The relationship can be written as epsilon F equal A transpose A inverse epsilon R, where epsilon R represents pseudo range measurement error. That is the error in the measurement of the distance of the satellite. And epsilon x represent the corresponding error in user position and clock period. Note that the relationship between the pseudo range measurement error, that is epsilon r, and user position and clock error is a function only of the solution matrix A, which in turn is a function only of the directional cosines of the line of sight from the user to the satellite, whichever coordinate system is used. So in other words, the error relationship are functions only of satellite geometry. The geometry of four satellites selected for position determination should be such that a given level of error in solar measurement results in a smaller user error in the solution. Loosely speaking, you can write error in position solution as a multiplication of geometry factor by pseudo-random error factor. The geometry factor is usually called GDOP, that is geometric dilution of position, and pseudo-random error factor is termed as a user-equivalent range error. So GDOP can be calculated once you know the geometry of that type and approximate position of user. So this value can be determined. User-equivalent range error, by knowing the approximately errors involved, you can know the values of user-equivalent range error. So the multiplication of these gives the accuracy of the satellite navigation system. For any navigation system developed, these two values will determine the accuracy of that system. If sigma squared, sigma y squared, sigma z squared, sigma t squared are the variance of user position and time, the error in user position is given by square root of sigma x squared plus sigma y squared plus sigma z squared, sigma t squared, that is equal to GDOP into sigma u vary. So this is how the error of the system can be determined. This relation shows that the value of GDOP is smaller for a selected force satellite, smaller will be the error in the position solution. So suppose you are able to see more than four satellites, you have to choose four satellites which give smaller GDOP. So that error is minimum. It can be shown that GDOP is inversely proportional to the volume of a tetrahedron formed by the four satellites with the user at the vertex. So in the next slide, I will be showing a diagram of the geometry of four satellites with a good GDOP and a poor GDOP. If the four satellites are wide apart, the volume of the tetrahedron formed by the four satellites with the user will be large and GDOP will be good. If the four satellites are close by, the volume of a tetrahedron formed by four satellites, the user will be small and GDOP will be poor. So this is basically the how the error is changing. So these are the four satellites selected quite wide apart. It is a good GDOP and this gives better accuracy than four satellites selected which are closer to each other and the volume of the tetrahedron is smaller. So this gives poor GDOP. In future, when there are more number of satellites available, you can select four satellites from different combinations as wide as possible and get good GDOP and better accuracy is possible from multiple satellites observations, multiple satellites developed by different countries. So this is basically the relationship between GDOP and user equivalent range error. So these are the major parameters used in satellite navigation. These are all fixed and the same value is to be used in solving the equation. The ellipsoid you see is WGS 84, MU major axis and flattening F 1 by F, where F is A minus B by A. That is A is MU major axis, B is semi major axis. Earth's angular velocity used is this because the system is Earth-centered, Earth-fixed system. So the Earth is assumed not rotating. So some correction, because in actual case, Earth is rotating and also satellite is moving. So some correction for angular velocity has to be applied to get to the Earth-centered, Earth-fixed system. Then there is the Earth gravitational constant that is used in the satellite position determination by the using the capillary parameter. And speed of light of vacuum is this value that is used to multiply the time delay. Multiply by this value only, you should be used. So these values are fixed and they are basically used in any satellite navigation system by the country they are generating. And the same constants have to be used, otherwise your values will be wrong. So there are advantages of satellite navigation. Bold wave coverage is possible because you can have a large number of satellites going round the world. So in fact, GPS can cover up to 70 degree north on either side. The most accurate position fix is possible, of the order of even 10 meter accuracy is possible compared to the other system. You can have cheap and handled user receiver is possible. Even you can have a chip which can go in your mobile. All weather capability, whether it is cloudy or raining or lightning and thunder, still the signals are so good that you can recover. And absolute 3D position is possible. That you can determine simultaneously latitude and longitude. In older surveys, latitude and longitude were determined by using a ground survey, and height it was determined by using tidal gauges. So, but They are independent of each other. But now, using satellite, 3D positioning is possible. Finally, I thank Professor Hari Om Bas, Director of Space Education and Research Foundation, for inviting me to give this talk and to share my knowledge on satellite navigation with you all. I thank various websites, including from ISRO, in providing the valuable resource material through their internet sites, which helped me to prepare this lecture. I also thank all the participants for attending my lecture and for interaction and discussion. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.